with you today and welcome you to Cardiff Church and Cardiff North Church worship service. Today we welcome you to our special Women's Sabbath, and we welcome our worship leader for the day, Sister Andrea Obiero, who will be welcoming and addressing us in just a second. But before we give her time, we just want to welcome everyone who is watching this Sabbath service with us and visiting our church on Facebook as well during the live broadcast. It's good to have you friends with us. May God bless you. And we welcome all the visitors as well to our church today. Andrea, may God bless you and your team and all the ladies who are taking part in the service, as well as your devices and internet connection. May God be with us and bless us all together this Sabbath.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you for that welcome. And good morning, everybody. Happy Sabbath to you all. I just want to welcome you all today. Today is a special day. It's International Women's Day of Prayer. And it's a day that is recognised throughout the whole church conference, both here in England and throughout the world. And today is when all ladies in church come together and pray and build a special bond with each other. So it's good to be with us today as we recognise this special day. Please join us today as we open our first service with hymn 456, My Lord and I.
Shall we pray? Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to bless your name for yet another beautiful Sabbath. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your guidance. Thank you for being our God. Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity to worship you once again. Father, in our ignorance, in our pain, in our joy, you've always come through for us. And for this, we worship you. Father, as we proceed even into the rest of the service this morning, we want to commit our gathering, our service into thy care. Father, we pray that you accept our service today, you will accept our worship, and you will come and fellowship with us, and you will bless us, and you will speak to us, and you will reveal yourself unto us even more. Father, we pray that that special message, that special information that you have for us, Father, we will receive it today. And even the blessing of the Sabbath will be ours, and all the blessings will be yours. Father, thank you because we know we can trust in you. Thank you because we know you are forever worthy. Father, we worship, accept our worship, even in Jesus' name. Amen. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. And now we're going to have our children's story by Sister Pixie. Hi, Sister Pixie, are you ready for us?
Have I got screen sharing, please?
You should now.
Okay, thank you. First of all, a little introduction. Obviously, this is Women's Ministry Day. So first of all, I thought I'd share this little video about a story that we all know very well, but I won't say any more until we watch the video. And afterwards, I'm going to share with you some of the ministry that the children and teenagers, young people, have been doing lately. So first of all, we're going to have a look at this little video about a story, as I say, we all know very well. So
hello boys and girls, this is Aunt Fernita, and I have a wonderful story for you called The Little Maid Serves God. Today's memory verse is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 16 and 17. May God strengthen you in every good deed and word. The message for today's story is we serve God by what we do and say. Do you know how to serve God? The little maid served God by what she did and said. The little slave girl carefully lifted the perfume bottles and dusted them. The bottles usually sparkled in the light that streamed through the bedroom windows. But not today. Today the curtains were closed, and Mrs. Naaman was sitting on her bed in the darkness, crying softly. The little maid knew why. Captain Naaman had leprosy. The leprosy made white spots on his skin, and he could not feel things with his fingers and toes. And this made Mrs. Naaman very, very sad. The little maid tiptoed quietly to the bed. I wish Master Naaman would go see the prophet in my country.
Sorry,
she whispered. Prophet Elisha would heal him of his leprosy. Mrs. Naaman wiped her eyes. What? What are you talking about, child? She asked. So the little maid told Mrs. Naaman all about the prophet Elisha who lived in Israel. The Lord of heaven works miracles through the prophet Elisha, she said. Then the little maid told Mrs. Naaman all she had learned from her parents about the true and living God. Mrs. Naaman scooted off the bed. Bring me some water to wash my face, she said. I must talk with my husband. Captain Naaman was the commander of the king's army. So Naaman told the king what the little maid had told his wife. Go, said the king. Go and visit the prophet. I will send a letter to the king of Israel for you. Captain Naaman took silver and gold coins and 10 sets of beautiful clothes with him. These would be gifts to the people in Israel who helped him. But when the king of Israel read the letter from the king of Syria, he was deeply troubled. The king of Israel knew that he could not heal Naaman. He didn't understand why the king of Syria thought he could heal Naaman. He was very worried. What if Naaman wasn't healed? Would the king of Syria attack Israel again? Prophet Elisha heard about Naaman's visit. Elisha sent Israel's king a message. Why are you so upset? Have Naaman come visit me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. Prophet Elisha knew that he couldn't heal Naaman, but God could. Prophet Elisha and the little maid both wanted Captain Naaman to know about the true God. The little maid showed her love of God as she helped Mrs. Naaman in everything she said. She loved to share God with others. And you can serve God too by what you do and say. That is how others will know that you love God. This podcast.
Thank you for listening to that. Now we're going to have a look at some things that the young people in our church have been doing. Okay, so we've been doing some ministry. We've been sharing cards with people, and between the children's ministry and help of Pathfinders, and mainly due to the children and young people, we've been doing this little bit of ministry. And we took advantage of the fact that we have days of, the world maybe has days of celebration. But I wanted to read this verse to you. It says, for this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to his riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all fullness of God. So as some of you know, we sent cards to people in our church. The children were supplied with cards to send mainly to the older members of the church, to let them know that we do love them and care for them and miss them. And they sent cards with some chocolates, photos of the last time the older members of the church had met up, which was in the celebration was at the Golden Stars meal they had in the last New Year, and also with a photo of the children at the nativity. And so they sent them to the older people, and also they had some extras if they wanted to send them to the neighbors. So this was some of the cards that we have Lena and Luca here with all the things that they had and colored in. They've got bookmarks. They sent a picture of themselves, and there's the picture of the Golden Stars at their meal. And we have some of the lovely cards that they colored in. I've had the privilege of viewing all of this stuff, but I'm the only one, I think, who's seen everybody's work. So I've tried to put a selection of people's work here. This is a beautiful little card they made to send to the person that they were connecting with.
Sorry, Pixie, I think you are not showing us what you're supposed to be. You're only showing the video right now.
Is it? Oh, yeah. Dear. Okay, let's go back to stop share, and then let's go to share again. Share screen. That's a shame. Share that one. Okay. Can you see that now?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Tim, for pointing that out. Right. Okay. Let's begin again. So, oh, let me go 1 minute because I'm right in the middle now. Right. Okay. So from the current slide, thank you, Tim. Here's a little selection of things that Lena and Luca did. So we've got the picture of Lena and Luca. We've got some bookmarks. We've got all things about love. We were also trying to teach the children about what love is, okay? And here's some of the colouring that they did on a card. That's from the small children, Luca, I think. And then here's a beautiful card that they've made to send, "We love you," with a little picture of themselves in together. And here's some things from the Labalan children. So we had cards which had scriptures on. So God is love and love one another. And they had scriptures inside. The older members, I know the pastor has had quite a lot of feedback about this because they didn't know the addresses of the children, the people, but they phoned him up to say, thank you for this activity. So these are some of the bookmarks that were coloured in. So I'd like you also to realise that all the children were involved with this and all have sent cards. This is little Apatsu, he's just 5, I think, still. And here he sent to Lilith, he said, "Love from Apatsu, you are the best." And I can assure you she really appreciated that. Then we had Cardiff North as well. And this lady, Gogo, is obviously very well loved in Cardiff North Church because she had messages from 2 families. So that was nice. Micaiah. So cards sent and personal messages sent by the children. So I thought this was a lovely way to share the ministry that the children have been doing. And different things about love there. And we had the message inside on the cards we gave out on St. David's Day, says we love because he first loved us. So Michaela and Tanisha as well. So it was a way of connecting with people. And also I like these little pictures of Lakeisha and her little brother. And Lakeisha wrote a beautiful long letter. So that's lovely. Mo wrote a lovely letter to Udal, which I'm sure she really enjoyed having the card. And Salvio, I even managed to get some of the older members of our group, teenagers, to actually get involved in this. So I wanted to share that with you, of all the things that they've been doing. And these were the chocolates that were sent to the older members. We've got Jethro's card. Zonse and James and Ellen, and they also sent a message to Goga or Gogo, I'm not sure how you say that. So you can see that a lot of love was sent out to the older members of our community, and also to some local people as well. So a lovely little card once again by Lena and Luca. And this is a beautiful picture, I think, with them doing their activities. And once again, so this is some of the, oops, let's go back a minute. This was just one or two messages. It says, "I received a lovely card and some photos from yesterday. What a beautiful surprise. I really appreciate it. It was a nice surprise from so-and-so. It lifted my spirits, so I can say that the outreach program you organized was a blessing to all of us." So this was some of the ministry that the children have been doing that I wanted to share with you. I also have another one I want to share with you, which they've just done this last week. Of course, We know that, hang on a second, this man David was a very simple man. He told the gospel of Jesus. He lived in Wales, you know, in 500 BC, and he lived a very simple life. He apparently was vegetarian, and he just drank water, but obviously he was well remembered because he spread the gospel. So these are pictures of the children who took some cards and some flowers to their neighbours. Lena in her Welsh costume. This is all the stuff that Lena and Luca have been making. And Mo. Mo gave a lovely testimony today in Sabbath school lesson to say that she's lived in her neighborhood for 9 years and didn't really know her neighbor, and how much appreciated it was that she knocked on the door and gave this card, and how people appreciated it. And it made her feel like she wants to actually get to know her neighbors in the future. So this was nice. So we have symbols of Wales here, the dragons and the daffodils and things. I just wanted you to appreciate as a church that we have many people, all the things that the children have done, lots of stuff. This is a nice little message from Jessica, wishing a great day and God be with you. There was a message in this site card to say, because we love because he first loved us. So we had messages of to do with the Bible in there. Michaela and Tanisha had a lovely thank you. The person they gave the card to actually gave it to their mother, and their mother sent them this thank you card that said, thank you so much for your lovely flowers and your kindness. It's very much appreciated. Thank you from Dorothy Rogers and family. And then we had Debbie and Dina, who also Debbie mentioned this morning in Sabbath school, how her neighbour, how she felt like, you know, in this crisis to reach out to her neighbour. And they had a nice little note from their neighbour which said, so that was what was inside. We love because we first loved, and from Cardiff then to Adventist Church. And then here her neighbour says, hi, dear Debbie and Dina, thank you so much for your lovely card. What a lovely thought and a surprise. I very much appreciate it, your neighbour Sylvia. So I just wanted to say that on this Women's Ministry Day, that we know that Naaman's, the servant ministered to Naaman by telling her about God. So telling him about God. So these children have been spreading some of the message about God in a quiet way, and by doing small things, and that they are being appreciated and they are ministering to people, but not just the girls, but also the boys of the church. So that's my children's story for you today, is the story of the servant girl who shared about God and also about what your children have been doing in their neighborhood. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sister Pitsu, for organizing this. It has been a blessing, and it's lovely to see all the children taking part and ministering. You know, the children are our future, and this is a time when we can mold them and get them ready to minister. So once again, thank you, Sister Pitsu, for that children's story and for doing this ministry. Okay, we're now going to have our offering time. I believe we have an order from Sister Ivy.
Happy Sabbath, Church. We thank God for his blessed Sabbath and what he has done for us all throughout the week. This is our tithe and offering promotion. Our world is made up of two categories of people: those who have and those who don't have. This picture is also found in the church of God. Paul in 2 Corinthians 9, 6 and 7 addresses this situation and how we respond to it. As Christians, we must begin to think seriously about our actions and inactions. He says, "He who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. He who sows generously will reap generously." In verse 7, God is telling us that each man must decide in his or her heart, for he loves a cheerful giver. The fact that God uses the verb "he" does not mean women are excluded. The "he" is generic, implying all. God is not looking at what is in our hands, but what is in our heart. In Proverbs 22:9, God through Solomon wrote, "A generous man will himself be blessed for sharing." The story is told of a woman who attempted to hide her porridge from visiting neighbors. In the process, she spilled the porridge all over. She wished she had not done so. The Bible says in Proverbs 11:24, "One man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty." Verses 25 says, "A generous man will prosper. He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed." In Proverbs 19:17, the word of God says, "He who is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward him for what he has done." There is no compulsion in giving, but it is refreshing to do so because God gives his only begotten Son to die for us in the time of our need and made steward over all resources that belongs to him. Friends, I urge you to consider your position today as a cheerful giver, born out of God. Born out of God's example. God bless you. May the God support us and be with us and speak to our hearts, direct us in all that we do in giving our tithe and offering. God bless you all.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Ivy, for sharing that with her. And now I invite Sister Clara as we go on to our main prayer.
Good morning, Church. Could I ask you all to take a comfortable position for our prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning as your children. We come to give you thanks. We come to give you praise. We come to ask, dear Lord, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for your kindness and mercy that you've shown us, especially in the last year with all the challenges we faced with the pandemic. Dear Lord, we've fallen short of your glory. We've been challenged, and there's been times when we've strayed from your path. Dear Lord, we pray that you forgive us. We pray that you cleanse us. We pray that you restore our hearts. Dear Lord, we pray that you accept us in thy presence and you listen to our prayers. Dear Lord, we want to give you thanks for the fact that we are alive today. Dear Lord, we thank you for healing that you've shown upon us and our family members, especially during the pandemic. Dear Lord, we thank you because you've still given us an opportunity to meet, or it be virtually, and worship. We know that other people are not able to do this. Dear Lord, we know that throughout this few months, we've lost friends and family. We can't question your will. It is difficult. And at this special time, I uplift all family members who've lost loved ones. I pray that you comfort them. I pray that you guide them. In a special way as a church, we uplift before you Brother George and his family. Dear Lord, he's had multiple losses in the family in the last few months. Dear Lord, it is difficult. Dear Lord, there's no amount of words that can describe what he's going through. But dear Lord, you've allowed it to happen. We pray that you comfort him. We pray that you give him strength. We pray that you give him resilience and you give him wisdom and you impart upon him knowledge, so that somehow he'll go through each and every day trusting that you're still in control. Amen. I do pray that as a church, you help us to be available for friends and family, even at this difficult time. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for each and every family gathered here. I want to thank you for the children who we've seen the brilliant work that they've been doing. May you continue to use them to minister your word. May you continue to water them so that their faith grows and they have a good foundation. We thank you for the teachers that are responsible for all this hard work. We thank you for Pix's hard work. We pray that you bless her. Dear Lord, we pray for the women ministries who are leading today. There are many, many challenges that as women we face on a daily basis. I pray, dear Lord, that even as we forge through the difficult days, you shall help us to stand firm and accept the challenges that you bring unto us. Help us to remain faithful and to continue to carry your word forward. I pray in a special way for the ladies who are taking part today. May you be with them. May you bless them. Dear Lord, we also pray for the men's ministry. Dear Lord, be with them, for together we'll work for your own good. Dear Lord, I pray for the church leadership. It has been a very challenging time, and the leadership are having to make very difficult decisions. Dear Lord, be with them, show them guidance, give them wisdom, so that in the end, whatever decision is made, we know that it has come from your throne. Amen. Dear Lord, we pray for friends and family, wherever they may be. May you watch over them and keep them safe. For those who are not able to join us online today, may you minister unto them in one way or another. I pray all of this in the name of our Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Now we have a special item by Anisha and Sister Liz.
There are trials in life that are more
takes beyond compare. With the trials in life, I may never bow in prayer, and I may never know Jesus really cares. Is the trials that bring us close to Jesus, and is the trials that bring blessings untold. Is the trials that bring us close to heaven, and is the trials that make you grow. With the trials in life, I may never know you, Lord, and I may never know the joy of answered prayers. With the trials in life, I may never hear the words, welcome me, my child, come in glory share. Is the trials that bring us close to Jesus, and is the trials that bring blessings untold. Is the trials that bring us close to heaven, and is the trials that make you grow, and is the trials that make you grow, and is the trials that make you grow.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for that beautiful item. I'm now going to invite Daiswa to share with us our scripture reading for this morning.
Good morning, Happy Sabbath Church. I hope you're well this morning. And the scripture reading will be from 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16 to 18. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Thank you for listening. May God bless the reading of the word.
Thank you so much for that reading. We now come to the part where we'll be hearing from our sisters. But before that, I just want to give a brief introduction. As I mentioned earlier, today is our Women's Ministry Day, and today that we have an opportunity to come together as sisters in Christ and to pray for one another and to minister with one another. We have four beautiful sisters in our church who are going to be sharing with us their testimonies around the title When a Prayer is Answered. We have Sister Maggie, Sister Sandy, Sister Sarah and Sister Duska, and I would like to express my thanks and appreciation for accepting this invitation and sharing the testimony and the story today. Church, be with us now. I ask you to open your heart and your mind and your ears and listen to what the special word these ladies have to say, and be blessed. Our first testimony will be from Sister Sandy.
Good morning, Church, and a happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Good morning. Today, the Women's Minister, I would like to share a testimony, and I hope it can be a blessing for you. I thank God for giving this opportunity. Through my experience, I have learned that God answers prayers, not because we are good because he's good. In Mark 11, chapter 11, 24 says, therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you have received them and you will have them. This verse taught me that whatever you ask in prayer, we need to believe that you have received it and it will be yours. I hope that my testimony can be assurance that Jesus stands ready to hear our cry and to answer all our prayers. He's interested in every details of our life, and he knows you are better than you know yourself. Some unanswered prayers are only because God doesn't want to do something for us. He wants to do through us. My testimony is regarding my sister. I have 8 brothers and sisters, and my younger sister, her name is Martha. She lives in India. She's a twin sister. Our other twin is living in UK with me. The twin sister who lives in India, she was saying that she was not well since last couple of weeks now. It's nearly 8 weeks now. She was always saying that she's having a high temperature in the nighttime, only in the night. In the daytime, she's okay with the day-to-day activities. So we advised her to go to the hospital and have a look at it. And when she went to see the doctor wants to have a CT scan done by their lungs because she was always coughing in the night. When they done the CT scan of the lung, they called her and back again and said, you need to come urgently. We need to discuss something urgently with them. So when she went and the doctor said, I'm sorry to say that you got a small lump under your lung and part of the lungs is small lump. They said, but I cannot say that what is at the moment. We need to have one more CT scan tomorrow. You need to come tomorrow, they said. She came home with a tearful heart and she was crying and she rang everybody, all my brothers and sisters. And we were so upset, but we prayed. And I said to her, don't be scared. God can do miracle in our life. Because when we are small, my father passed away when I was age of 5. My younger sister was Martha. She was only 1 year, but my mom was a very uneducated lady. She didn't have any support, but God brought us very faithfully. We had a lot of difficult times. So I told my sister to be faith and don't be scared. We all were praying. So we met in Zoom and we prayed, we fasted and we were earnestly praying to God. I said to God, it's if your will, everything should be all right, I said to her, but we'll hand over to your hand, I said. And she went next day, she had a CT scan done. And I thank God, they said, that's not a tumor. But when they said, but, she was a little bit worried. They said, it's definitely not a tumor, but we don't know what the lump is. They said, there may be tuberculosis, they said. But they gave the assurance that tuberculosis will be cured within 6 months if you take a treatment, they said. She came home and she texted everyone. We had a chat. We had a Zoom meeting. We prayed. We praised God saying that it's not a tumor. And we said, it's your will, God. If it's tuberculosis, we don't mind. But still we pray and trust you that you can change everything in our life, we said. And after 1 week, that was 2 weeks back, she had a sputum sample and the doctor wants her to have a sputum sample and a lot of blood tests and x-rays, lot of investigations she underwent. After all this, after 2 days, and the last 2 days, we were really praying for her earnestly. I know that God can answer our prayer because I had a lot of experience through Jacob. When Jacob was not well, we prayed, God answered our prayer. So I said to my sister, Jacob is a real testimony and he's living at the moment, so you believe God can do miracle in your life also. She had a faith and we all had a faith and we prayed and last Monday the doctor called her and her family and said, it's a really good news, it's not a tuberculosis, they said. I praise God for that, the two big dangerous procedures we underwent, but God, all the sputum sample on the blood test, everything came negative. And the doctor said, because she's a twin, maybe she'd have born with the lump and it may go slowly. And they said, maybe because of the lump is getting infected, that's why she's having temperature. So they said, it's nothing to worry, it's not life threatening. We praise God for that. And they said, we'll start with a little bit of antibiotic. Hopefully that lump will disappear. They may say, they were thinking it may be small fat formation. So the good news was, in the early beginning, we thought something will be different, but God changed everything to her life. So she's the testimony at the moment. We all praise God that God has given her good health, because she's only 38 years old now. She got only a little boy. So we were a little bit worried about her, but God has blessed us and give us, he answered our prayer. I can say that many prayers we did, but God answered our prayer. He's there to answer prayer. I would like to thank for everyone, our family members, and I thank God for praying for us. And I would like to finish with reading Isaiah chapter 28, verse 2 to 5. Then Ezekiel turned his face towards the wall and prayed to the Lord and said, "Remember now, O Lord, I pray, how I have walked before you in truth and with royal heart, and I have done what is good in your sight." And Ezekiel wept bitterly. Verse 4 says, and the word of the Lord came to the Isaiah saying, "Go and tell Isaiah, thus says the Lord, the God of David, your father, I have heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Surely I will add your days 15 years. I always remember, since my sister was ringing me and talking about her life, I was sharing these words with her and saying that God can do miracles. He can add 15 years to Ezekiel's life. He will definitely bless you and give you more years to come," I said. So I thank God for giving this opportunity. Especially I thank God for the church for sharing this testimony. Please continue to pray for her to be more closer to God, and our faith will be growing, God. And thank you so much.
Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Santi, for sharing that with us. What a mighty God we serve. We can never doubt him. Now we're going to have our next testimony from Sister Margaret.
Happy Sabbath, saints of God. My name is Maggie Mangalika. I just want to share one of my great testimonies I have gone through in my life. As a mother of two boys, I desired to have a girl, and I was waiting on God's promises for God to give me a girl, and at his own time God gave me a girl. But this is not about this testimony now today, but I just want to share you a testimony how my only girl was saved when she was about to be killed in an accident, but this could have been happened at home. We went on holiday to Africa in Malawi, and we went to live with my husband in our old house, which we used to live before. As we know, in Africa, the houses, because of security, we have got big fences and gates which need to be opened when either somebody is coming in or when the car is coming in. So one day my husband went to work and he left us at home with me, Jessica, my daughter, and my nephew, who is Jessica's cousin. And we were waiting for my husband to come home so that we can go to attend an engagement party. Anyway, when when he was coming home, my husband knocked on the door so that we can be opened for, because he was driving, he can't come out. So he did that, he blew a horn, and the two children, Jessica was 3 years now that time, and my nephew was 6 years that time. Anyway, those two children, they ran to the gate to open the gate. And when my husband came in, because it was a big car, a 4x4, he did not see that the one who has opened the door, the gate door, is one of the young children, and Jessica was among them. Anyway, because Jessica wasn't used to opening the gates, but the cousin used to open the gates, or even though he was six, and he said, Jessica, run, as the car was coming into the compound. But because he said it was a big car, and my husband did not see Jessica running, he sort of knocked Jessica at a little bit, I think, at the back of the car. And then he swerved and he parked the car, not knowing that Jessica is under the car. And as this was happening, I was standing on the veranda and I saw everything, because I thought this is the end of my little girl. And when I was standing there, I prayed a short prayer and said, God, save my daughter. And as I was saying this prayer, I recalled on Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3, as I always use that as my emergency, because it's 333 in a medical term, that's an emergency. So I quoted Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3, to say, please God, I am calling to you now, please save my daughter. Lo and behold, my husband stopped the car. He did not know anything that has happened, but I was standing there on the veranda crying that you have killed my daughter. And he was confused, because he didn't know anything about it, that Jessica was opening the gate door with her cousin. So when I said, you've killed our daughter, and he was confused, and I said, I can't see her. And then she said, oh, where is she then? So we went, ran down and looked, and we found Jessica under the car in between the hills. She wasn't hurt, but she wasn't crying. She was just frozen. When we called her name, she started crying. But when we took her out of that car, out of the bottom of that car, under the car, we stood her, she stood. And we talked to her. There was nothing which was scratched on her body. There was no scratch cage. There was nothing on Jessica's body. God saved the child in a twinkle of an eye. This is the testimony of an answered prayer imminently. That's why I'm sharing this testimony today, that God can answer the prayers imminently. We took Jessica to the hospital just for checkup, but everything was okay. And here she is. She will be turning 10 in May, and I praise God for saving my daughter. Have a very good Sabbath day. Good afternoon.
Amen. Thank you so much for such a powerful testimony. It's just one of the evidence of God is not sleeping. God is with us in a time when we least expect him to be. He is there. And we praise God for Jessica, and Jessica is still with us. Thank you so much, Sister Maggie. And now we have a third testimony by Sister Sarah.
Hello, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Today I want to talk to you about the story of what happened in 2020 in my life. There's been a lot of different things that were happening throughout the year, so I will do my best to fit everything in the time frame. But As many of you may realize, I got married last year, and before we got married, my now husband lived in Brazil, so we were in a long distance relationship for a bit over 2 years. And towards the end of 2019, beginning of 2020, we decided that we do want to get married. Our initial plan involved him coming here in the beginning of May. We would then go to Poland, where we actually wanted to get married because all of my family is there. And to get married in Poland, we also had to first go to court and have the judge approve our marriage in a way. It was mostly to prove that we are actually getting married because we love each other and not because he needs a visa to be in Europe. So the initial plan was around the beginning of May, he will come here, we will have a date in court, hopefully as soon as possible in May, and then we'll get married around June. So we sort of started getting excited and planning for all of this. We bought tickets for the 1st of May. And of course the pandemic was already happening in the meantime. So we were sort of monitoring the news, checking if there was no restrictions on him coming here. There was nothing at the time. And the day came, and he called me from the airport and told me that, that the airline told him that he's not able to fly and that the UK borders are closed and he won't be able to fly. Now, Ihan and Tim are probably laughing to themselves because they've heard all of this as it was happening. But I checked multiple times and there was nothing at the time. Yes, Tim. There was nothing at the time of in May that UK government had in place to sort of reduce the travel to UK. Yes, he couldn't enter European Union, but it wasn't applying to UK. Anyway, he couldn't come. And it was devastating for both of us because we were all very excited to see each other and we haven't seen each other for months at the time. Going towards May, the main prayer I had was, God, just let everything go smoothly so that he can come here. So when it all happened, I sort of just went, why? That was the one thing I've asked you about for the last couple of months. Why did you not let this happen? So we moved on. We decided to try again in July with a completely different airline. So the day comes, we are of course extremely nervous at the time to not have the repetition of what happened in May. And he arrives at the airport, he goes through security, goes through passport control, boards a plane, arrives in UK, goes through the smoothest passport control we've both ever seen. And I'm sure a lot of you know how it is to be an international person coming to UK and having to explain every bit of your life and why are you not going to be a burden for UK. The passport control took maybe 30 seconds. He arrived to Cardiff. Everything went perfectly fine. Our lawyer contacted us, the lawyer who was in Poland, that we got a date in court in Poland on the 28th of August. So we traveled to Poland, we went to court, everything went smoothly, no issues whatsoever. We decided to get married, as soon as possible, because we were on a time frame when it comes to his tourist visa. So we set a date for 27th of September, which was at the time less than a month from the day we were at, because we didn't really want to plan anything before we went to court. And So we started planning, and since I was a little girl, I had one place in my home city that I dreamed of being married in. You know, it's top of the mountains, beautiful views. And normally that place has to be booked at least a year in advance to even dream of having a wedding there. And somehow they had this day free. Then we call the person who was supposed to take care of the music during the wedding. He was living in UK, but he was in Poland during that time. So we moved on to a photographer. It was the first photographer I thought about and I wanted. 27th of September was the only day he had free within a span of 3 months. My dress was ready within a week of ordering it. Everything, literally everything, went as smoothly as possible. Our witnesses came from UK, and both ourselves and them managed to come back to UK literally 2 or 3 days before UK closed the borders. So none of us had to actually quarantine. None of our works were affected by this. So at the time I started realizing that that was supposed to be the time from the very beginning. If it happened the way we planned, if God just listens to my initial prayer, my sort of blind prayer, we probably couldn't have our friends there because May and June were still pretty bad when it comes to lockdowns in Poland. So we would have had to cut down the amount of people at least in half. Our friends wouldn't be able to come. The place wouldn't probably be able to have us because it was still very much locked down. So the sort of August-September window was when we were allowed to not only travel freely between Poland and UK, but also get all the guests that we wanted, have the place, have the photo, everything. Then I started realizing that if he came in May and we still would have the date court date in August, that wouldn't have changed whether he was here in May or July. But what would have changed is that we would run out of time to apply for his visa before his tourist visa ended. So if he would have come here in beginning of May, he would need to just go back to Brazil before we even managed to get married because of all the delays that happened with the court. So if it was for our plans, maybe he would come here initially, but everything else would have gone wrong. God had a plan from the very beginning, and he knew the right dates, and he knew when we will be able to do everything the way we wanted to do it. Last part of this whole puzzle was my job. Because of all this, the traveling back and forth, I had to take quite a lot of annual leave. And in the first half of the year, so around May and June, I was on a project where this would be very difficult to manage, to ask for over 3 weeks in a row of annual leave. But what happened is that I was being moved to a different project, and this transition happened exactly throughout August and September, which meant I was able to postpone the start of the new project up until the 1st of October, which meant I could take all the leave I needed to plan the wedding, to come back here safely. And it's just, when I was writing this down and to sort of not forget any of the pieces, I realized how much we sometimes don't realize the plans that God has for us, and that his plans are always gonna be the right one. And he loves us and he wants us to be happy and he will make it happen. And sometimes it feels that initially everything is going wrong and he's not listening to us. But if anything, it taught us to have a full trust in him, because he will take care of us and he will make it happen in the best way possible, in a way that we can't even imagine. So thank you for everyone who were my prayer warrior throughout this time. And God really listens to our prayers, and he has the best way of doing things. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Sarah, for that beautiful testimony. Yes, God always has a plan for us. Even when we make plans and it doesn't go the way we want it to, there's always a reason, and that's why we should leave it in the hands of the Lord. Thank you very much. We now come to the end where we'll be hearing from our Sister Gusta.
Okay. Hello. Hello, everyone. It's just very interesting topic that we are thinking about or talking about today, when a prayer is answered. For me, it is difficult to think or to talk about this topic without actually thinking about what the prayer is. And there are so many lovely definitions of prayer, and each one of them giving us different perspective of what the prayer actually is. But I asked Lena the other day, and I said, Lena, what the prayer is for you? And she said, Mommy, prayer is when you kneel down, you close your eyes, and then you say something to God. So then I asked her, okay, but what do you say to God? And she said, you know, something like, you know, if you lost something, or if you are hurt, you're in pain. So then I ask again, so do we only pray to God when we need something or when we have a problem? She said, yes. So I ask her again, okay, are you sure? And then she said, oh, Mommy, we need to pray as well to say thank you to God. So very often when Lena is praying, she's giving thanks without asking for anything. But still, when I ask her what a prayer is, she immediately connected prayer with needs, with problems, with something that we want. And I think that majority of us do the same thing. I mean, I'm not saying that we are not giving thanks to God. I'm just saying that very often when we think prayer, we think problems, needs, something that we want. And obviously this is natural, because this is one big and very important aspect of prayer. And I'm not saying just because we want something, we are praying to God, and then he grants us our wish. But I'm saying, looking from the perspective of witnessing. You know, when you're talking about God to somebody, and then you use all the arguments that God exists and all the theories and knowledge that you have, but sometimes this is still not enough. What I think is, like, the best evidence or the best proof that God exists is our personal relationship with God. And this comes to prayer. And once, when you experience God's existence, when you are convinced of God's existence through answered prayers, nobody can take this away from you. Nobody can convince you otherwise or say God doesn't exist. You don't have enough evidence. Like some sisters already mentioned before, when God is answering our prayers, very often it is answered in such a way that we are thinking this was God's doing. There is no way that this was coincidence. I heard so many times when people were sharing their testimonies, I had one idea and I was praying, but when it happened, I was amazed how all the pieces, all parts fit together perfectly well into this bigger picture. And this is God answering our prayers. And as I said, once when we experience these answered prayers, we can understand the importance of prayer and the power of prayer. When I think about prayer, for me, this is just, I would define it as a simple conversation between my God and me. But you see, what is for me very difficult in this conversation, it is not to talk. Even if I'm very sad, even if I'm discouraged, it's not difficult for me to talk. But very often in this conversation with God, for me, it is difficult to listen, especially when God seems silent. We heard some lovely experiences today when the prayers were answered. But let me rephrase this. We heard some lovely experiences today when the prayer were answered and the answer was yes. Because I strongly believe that there is no such a thing as an unanswered prayer. There is only answers that we do not like. You know, we like when we pray to God that he answers with yes and quickly and on the way that we want it. We struggle a little bit when the answer is wait. Or when the answer is yes, but not according to your own desires. But I think that we struggle the most when the answer is no. And that is possible as well. And this is not because we've done something wrong. Job didn't do anything wrong. Sometimes it is not because we were asking for something that was not good or that we didn't have the right motivation. Sometimes it's not even about learning, case of learning something from this painful experience. It is just a simple no, without explanations, reasons given. Just one simple thought. And this thought should be enough. Trust your God. It's heartbreaking, it is disappointing, it's painful, but just trust God, no matter what. And this is tough. So I just mentioned that we have three answers to our prayers: yes, no, and wait. So how do we feel with these answers? I mean, obviously, when the answer is yes, we are excited. We are on top of the world. We are thinking, oh, God hears me. I have this strong connection with my God, and he hears and answers my prayer, and everything is perfect. But then when the answer is wait, if we only have to wait for a few days, usually we are fine. But what if we have to wait several weeks or a few months? What about several years? When you wait for something important and it's not happening, how do you feel? Very often this becomes a burden. You feel sad. There is this anxiety. Is God going to respond? How long I need to wait? Is his answer going to be yes or is going to be no? Majority of you are aware that David and I prayed this one prayer for 10 years. 10 years of uncertainty, God's silence, so many questions. When you wish for something and you wish for something good, but you wish for it so badly, it becomes your life. It consumes you. And you know it's not healthy. And you know theory. And you know you have all this knowledge about God and he hears you and he loves you and you are aware, but still experiencing pain for so long and knowing the theory are two different things. It is tough. And somebody said once, and please try to remember this and to remind yourself often, that the things you take for granted, somebody else is praying for. You are healthy, but somebody is not. We have this freedom to worship our God, but somebody is praying for this freedom. You have children, as simple as that. But David and I wanted to have a child, at least one, we were saying to God, long before Lena was born. And about this experience and this 10, for me, very long years of waiting, I could spend at least 1 or 2 more hours preaching. But don't worry, I'm not going to do this today. Somebody said our prayers, they don't have expiration date. You never know when, where, or how God will answer. All you have to do is continue praying and trust. Trust God. Trust, but not that you will always be happy, not that all your prayers will be positively answered, but trust that at the end, everything will be okay. I lost this conviction while I was waiting for 10 years for my prayer to be positively answered. But I'm really thankful and grateful to God that he gave me back this conviction, and he gave me this conviction back before my prayer has been answered, positively answered. and what conviction. At that point, I didn't know if I ever going to have a child. I didn't know what is going to happen. But I again started to believe everything is going to be okay. How okay, I couldn't say. But I started to believe everything is going to be okay at the end. And I was thinking and praying, if it is not okay now, and if I don't feel okay now, it means it is still not the end. So after having a first child, David and I were so happy. We were over the moon and we were so grateful to God. And obviously we were sharing our experience because we wanted to praise God. And also we wanted to encourage people never to give up, to be patient, to trust God, to keep on praying and praying and praying. And like our scripture reading invites us to do, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks to God in all circumstances. But I must say, this was our experience, one of our experiences when it comes to prayer. And this is only one way of how we can experience things while we are waiting for God to answer our prayers. Because there were so many other occasions in life when I was waiting for my prayer to be answered, but I was not sad. I was excited. I was eagerly waking up every morning and I was praying to God and I was challenging God and I was saying, give me this miracle. Show me your power today. And I must say, I've done something wrong and I didn't have any right for my prayer to be answered. But still, I was praying humbly, not arrogantly, but I was praying to God every day, give me this miracle today as you gave me the day before. Show me your power. And God gave me this miracle day after day. And I was again grateful and I was sharing these experiences with other people in order to praise God. And let me present one more perspective. He said, while we are waiting for our prayers maybe to be answered positively, we might suffer and be in a lot of pain. We might be excited, but we may also be just living our everyday life like nothing happened, like Daniel. Let me give you this perspective of waiting period. In the book of Daniel, we can learn a lot of things when it comes to praying from Daniel's experiences. So Daniel got this vision. It's written in the chapter 8, and he was frightened about it. And he prayed to God because he couldn't understand it. So he prayed to God so that God can explain this vision to him. But God seemed silent. 2-3 years later, Angel Gabriel came and explained or answered Daniel's prayer. And he said, this is Daniel 9:23. At the beginning of your supplications, the command went out, and I have come to tell you, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider the matter and understand the vision. And then I'm not going to go in details now, but I just want to mention another occasion. Soon after, Daniel was praying again, and he was praying this time for 3 weeks, and his prayer has been again answered positively. And listen, Daniel 10, verse 12. Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, and behold, Michael came to help me, etc., etc. What is written in these few sentences that I've read is that, Daniel, your prayers have been answered from the very beginning. But in this second occasion, he said, I wanted to come, but I was busy up there. We keep forgetting that we are in the middle of this war, and we are not the only one who are fighting. The angels are fighting as well. So sometimes our prayers had been answered positively from the very beginning, but we were just not aware of it. Like Daniel, we think sometimes God is silent. We think that he didn't hear our prayer. Sometimes people tend to think God doesn't care about me or he doesn't love me. But in both of these occasions, it has been said to Daniel, Oh, Daniel, man, greatly beloved. So even if sometimes we feel that God is silent or he doesn't hear us, he still cares. He still loves us. So that was while we are waiting, we can suffer. We can be patient, but we can just move on like Daniel and do our job and you just live an ordinary life. I'm not saying this is easy. I'm just saying these are the different ways how we are dealing in this period of waiting. But the final thing is, how do we feel when the answer to our prayer is no? David shared our experience of this long waiting for our child, first child to arrive to a good friend, with a good friend. And she was listening because she was repeating this specific prayer, important for her, for years. And then when David finished his experience, she said, but you see, she was really sad. She said, but you see, God answered positively to your prayer. And on my prayer, the answer is still wait or no. But what she said as well is like in all these long years, because she started to pray her prayer long before David and I started to pray for our children. She learned and she came to this conclusion that while she was waiting for her prayer to be answered, she missed many opportunities. She was so focused and she was specifically praying for something, thinking that this is God's will and this is the best thing for her. And I think that God from the very beginning knew that this is not good enough for her, that there is something better, and he wanted to bless her with something better. But she was so focused on her prayer and how she wanted things to happen that she missed many opportunities. God was closing certain doors and he was opening others, but she just couldn't see them. Mother Teresa said, God speaks in silence of the heart. Listening is the beginning of prayer. And that is what I said at the beginning. Prayer should be a conversation, not monologue. We need to learn to listen. The sister has mentioned earlier, Jeremiah 33:3. Call to me and I will answer you. 1 John 5:14 says, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. God hears us, but sometimes we do not listen. However, sometimes it's not that we didn't listen. Sometimes it's not that we didn't have enough faith. Or there is nothing wrong in what we ask and want. Even if you ask for something specific, sometimes the answer is just a simple no. Without explanation, as I mentioned earlier, without any reasons given to us. But what we are doing then? We need to accept it. We need to trust God and move on with our lives, like Daniel did. In Daniel 8:27, it is written, so I, Daniel, was overcome and lay sick for some days. But then I arose and went about the king's business. He went back into routine, doing his job and living his life. Our attitude matters. It matters a lot. Because Satan never gives up. He attacks us constantly, so we should never stop praying. These constant prayers, they are not for God. They are for us. As Soren Kierkegaard said, prayer does not change God, but it changes him who prays. Constant prayer will change you. It will make you stronger. John F. Kennedy said once, we are not supposed to pray for easy lives. We need to pray to be stronger. Constant prayers will change our perspective or strengthen our perspective. It's going to allow us to see the bigger picture. So even when we feel that God's present, that God is not present, that he doesn't hear us, be sure that he hears our prayers. Sometimes we don't even have to use words. Somebody said as well, when you can't put your prayer into words, God hears your heart. And Gandhi said, it's better in a prayer to have a heart without words than words without heart. So never give up. Persevere. There are so many verses from the Bible that are inviting us to do this. Keep strong, stay strong, never stop praying. Because if you are praying only when you are in trouble, somebody says, then you are in a big trouble. And challenge God in your prayer. Say to God, pray to God, show me your power. Give me this miracle, God. And I will praise you no matter what. When it's tough, try to deal with it. Trust God and just move on like Daniel. And I know this is very, all of this, very easy to say, but very difficult to live. But we need always to remember, we are in the middle of this war. We know that Satan lost this war, but he still eagerly fights every single battle. He is pushing and he is pushing and he wants to discourage us and he is fighting because he wants to make our lives miserable. And he still has authority over this world. However, he doesn't have authority over our hearts. This is our choice. Who rules my heart? No matter what, no matter the circumstances, always be joyful. Never stop praying. Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Duska, for that inspirational summary of today's service. I hope you're all been blessed and inspired by what has been shared with us today. We're now going to our last item, hymn, You Are Not Alone.
We are not alone, we are not alone, we are not alone, God is with us, we are not alone. We are not alone, we are not alone, God is with us, we are not alone. We are not alone, we are not alone, God is with us, we are not alone. We are not alone, we are not alone, God is with us, we are not alone. We are never alone. Ever and ever, we are never alone. I'm not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. God is with us. We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. God is with us. We
Father, we thank you for allowing us today to meet together. We thank you for our special sister who has blessed us with her testimony this morning. We thank you for the inspiration. We thank you for the encouragement. We thank you for allowing us to speak among us. Lord, as we close our service today, I ask you to be with us, strengthen us, preserve us, direct us and protect us, and wherever we go in our lives, and whatever direction we're going. Lord, as we end today, thank you for blessing us with this beautiful Sabbath day, and being with us throughout this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, and we've come to the end of our service. Thank you for being with us, and I hope you've all been blessed. And we do have an afternoon program with the mission. I'm hoping that there is a poster that can show you a link in for all sisters who wish to join. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you all the ladies from both Cardiff and Cardiff North churches for a very lovely day and a service, especially for letting us to witness your faith. And I believe that every one of us attending this service can actually be encouraged to never give up on our God. That is one of the things that I'm taking from myself, and I'm glad that you've reminded us that God is there all the time. So for all of us who are watching this program on Facebook, this is the moment when we say goodbye and a happy Sabbath to you, and thank you for worshiping with us today. For those of you who are on Zoom and who would like to stay for the discussion time, we will have just a minute or two of our break, and then we will have some opportunity to talk a little bit more about church being the family of God. So use this time to stretch a little bit, and we can be with one another in just a little while.